Hello, everybody. If we could just find our seats, we'd like to get started. So today, I have the absolute pleasure to introduce one of the best speakers we have to offer, Dr. Walter Williams. Dr. Williams is a John M. Olin Distinguished Professor of Economics at George Mason University and is a syndicated columnist and author and has been involved with YAF for many years. Williams has previously taught at Los Angeles City College, California State University, Los Angeles, Temple University, and Grove City College. Since we're all college students here, I think we can appreciate how brave it is to teach at a campus like Cal State LA and preach against socialism, especially in today's campus climate. Williams is also currently an adjunct scholar at the Heritage Foundation and the Cato Institute. If you recognize Williams, you've probably seen him on one of his columns, which are on over 150 publications, appearing in scholarly journals such as the Cornell Journal of Law, Newsweek, National Review, Reader's Digest, Cato Journal, Town Hall, Jewish World Review, and newspapers all across the United States. I would go as far as to say he's quite the distinguished writer. He's also written several books, including The State Against Blacks, A Minority Viewpoint, and All It Takes Is Guts. If you don't recognize him from those, you might have seen him recently on Live In TV, and I know you must recognize him from Young America's Foundation's film, The Conservatives. Williams is well known for his libertarian conservative views, focusing mostly on personal liberty, Second Amendment rights, and free markets. Limited government is the only way to achieve these freedoms, for which reason he has passionately debated the overreach of the federal government and the implications it has on our lives. He intellectually proves that laissez-faire capitalism has indeed been and will continue to be the most moral economic system in the history of the world. Every speaker here has individual stories and experiences that make their arguments on free speech, free enterprise, and personal liberty crucial to a successful society, and we are lucky to have his perspective here today. Let's all welcome Dr. Walter Williams.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for that very warm welcome. The title of my talk today is The Legitimate Role of Government in a Free Society. And in the course of my comments, I'm going to say some things that may sound uncaring, insensitive, mean, politically incorrect. To the extent that any of those are true, you should feel free to raise any kind of question that you want. Don't worry about insulting me. I am uninsultable. The only way you could possibly insult me is suggest that I wasn't pretty good in basketball. And that's a matter of ethnic pride that I take seriously. One of the justifications for the growth of government, far beyond that envisioned by the founders, is to promote fairness and justice. Well, that might be a worthy goal, but we might also ask, what is fairness and justice? What is the legitimate function of government in a free society? Let me spend a few minutes discussing what the founders saw as the legitimate role of the federal government. And to do that, let's turn to the rule book that they gave us, namely, the United States Constitution. Most of what the founders saw as the legitimate role of the federal government is found in Article 1, Section 8 of the United States Constitution. Allow me to briefly quote sections thereof. It says that Congress shall have the power to lay and collect taxes, duties, imposts, and excises to pay the debts and provide for common defense and the general welfare of the United States. It also authorizes Congress to borrow money on the credit of the United States, to regulate commerce with foreign nation and among the several states and with Indian tribes. The Article 1, Section 8 also authorizes Congress to coin money, establish post office and post roads, to raise and support armies. The founders granted Congress taxing and spending authority for these and a few other activities. Matter of fact, if you look at Article 1, Section 8, Congress is authorized to do 21 things. Nowhere in our Constitution do we find authority for Congress to tax and spend for up to 3/4 of what Congress taxes and spends for today. In other words, there's no constitutional authority for farm subsidies, bank bailouts, welfare, not to mention midnight basketball. I think that we can safely say that we've made a significant departure from the constitutional principles of individual freedom and limited government that made us a rich nation in the first place. And these principles of freedom were embodied in our nation through the combined institutions of private property and free enterprise. Now, through numerous successful attacks, private property and free enterprise, what some people call capitalism, that the framers envisioned are mere skeletons of their past. And Thomas Jefferson anticipated this when he said, and I quote him, "The natural progress of things is for government to gain ground and for liberty to yield." The best way of looking at this process of how government is gaining ground and liberty yielding is to ask what has happened to taxation and spending in our nation. Ladies and gentlemen, there's only one way to look at taxation. Taxes represent government claims on private property. And indeed, if government were to tax at 100%, it would just confiscate private property. An even better measure of what government does is to look at what has happened to spending over the course of our history. In 1902, for example, expenditures at all levels of government totaled $1.7 billion. The average taxpayer that year paid $60 in federal, state, and local taxes. In fact, from 1787 until 1925, federal expenditures were a mere 3% of the GDP, except during wartime. Today, federal expenditures alone are close to $4 trillion, slightly over $4 trillion, nearly 25% of the GDP. State and local governments spend about $3 trillion. That means today, the average taxpayer pays more than $10,000 in federal, state, and local taxes. Now, the significance of this is that as time goes by, you and I own less and less of our most valuable property, namely ourselves and the fruits of our labor. Another way of looking at this is that the average taxpayer works from January 1st until the beginning of May to pay federal, state, and local taxes. And what that means is that we're going on 5 months out of the year, and we do not have rights to decide how the fruits of our labor will be used. Somebody else makes that decision. And keep in mind that in slavery, you work all year, and it's somebody else who makes the decision how the fruits of your labor will be used. Now, in the economic sphere, the founders thought that relatively free markets, or what is called capitalism, was the most effective social organization for the promotion of individual freedom. Indeed, capitalism is defined as a system wherein individuals are free to pursue their own interests. There's voluntary exchange. There are private property rights in goods and services. Much of the original intent of the United States Constitution, as seen in the document itself, and also as seen in the documents that debated the Constitution, such as the Federalist Papers, was to bring about a climate in which this kind of social organization could occur. Now, the great benefit of the free enterprise system is that through private ownership and control, it minimizes the capacity of one person to coerce another person. Additionally, the coercive powers of the state are minimized and restricted to the legitimate functions of the state in a free society. And what are the legitimate functions of the state in a free society? Well, one legitimate function is to protect you and me against international thugs violating our private property rights. So that says that one legitimate function is to provide for national defense. Another legitimate function of the state in a free society is to protect you and me from domestic thugs violating our private property rights. And so that says at some level there should be the provision of police services. And by the way, when I say private property, I mean ourselves. That is, I belong to Walter Williams and you belong to you. You are your own private property. Now, other legitimate functions of the state in a free society are those of enforcing constitutional order, the adjudication of disputes, and the provision of certain public goods that benefit all Americans as opposed to specific Americans. In order to pay for these legitimate functions and constitutionally mandated functions, each of us is obligated to pay our share, according to the Constitution. Now, some people might argue, or some of your professors or some of your lawyers might say, well, this guy Williams, he's being too limited about the Constitution. The Constitution is a living document. Well, anybody who says that the Constitution is a living document is at the same time saying that we don't have a Constitution. That is, in order for a Constitution to mean anything, it must be fixed. That is, we can think of the Constitution as our rules of the game. Anybody who says that the Constitution is living, he's ignoring the fact that we have a Constitution at all. Or think of it this way. How many of you would like to play me poker this evening and the rules be living? And maybe under certain circumstances, my two pair can beat your three of a kind. Now, the Constitution is indeed flexible. The founders built some flexibility in the Constitution, namely Article 5, as a way to amend the Constitution. Now, for the last half century, free enterprise and what it implies has been under unrelenting attack in our country. Americans from all walks of life, whether they realize it or not, have demonstrated a deep and abiding contempt for private property rights, economic freedom, and privacy. Free enterprise is threatened today, not because of its failure, but it's threatened because of its success. That is, capitalism and free enterprise has been so successful in eliminating the traditional problems of mankind, such as disease, pestilence, hunger, and gross poverty, that all other human problems appear to us to be at once inexcusable and unbearable. The desire by many Americans to eliminate these so-called unbearable and inexcusable problems has led us away from those basic ideals and principles upon which our prosperous nation has been built. In the name of other ideals, such as equality of income, sex and race balance, affordable housing, medical care, orderly markets, consumer protection, energy conservation, just to name a few, we have abandoned many personal liberties. As a result of widespread control by our government in an effort to achieve these so-called objectives, we are being increasingly subordinated to the point where considerations of personal liberty are but secondary or tertiary matters. That is where considerations of personal liberty in our country are treated as dirt. Now you might say, well, what's this guy talking about, treated as dirt? Well, imagine I write a letter to the United States Congress, and I tell them, my name is Walter Williams, and I am an emancipated adult. I am perfectly taking care of my own retirement needs. If I fail to do so, let me starve or go begging, but stop taking money out of my paycheck for Social Security. How do you think that'd be greeted? It'd be greeted with contempt. That is, here are some people telling me how much I should set aside out of each week's pay for retirement. Suppose they told me how much I should set aside out of each week's pay for entertainment, for food, or housing. We would see that as tyranny. Now, as I said, the ultimate end to this process is totalitarianism, which is no more than a reduced form of servitude. Now, I'm not saying that we are a totalitarian nation yet, but if you ask the question, which way are we headed, tiny steps at a time, are we headed towards more personal liberty or more government control over our lives? It would unambiguously be the latter, more government control over our lives. Now keep in mind that if you take tiny steps towards any goal, it's just a matter of when you're going to reach it. Or as the great philosopher David Hume said, it is seldom that liberty of any kind is lost all at once. It's always lost bit by bit. Or perhaps more insightful or more descriptive is a statement by my late colleague, Leonard Reed, who was the founder of Foundation Economic Education. Leonard Reed said, if you wanted to take liberty away from Americans, you had to know how to cook a frog. Leonard Reed said, you cannot cook a frog by putting on a pot of boiling water and then throwing the frog in the water. His reflexes are so quick, as soon as his feet touch the water, he would hop away and be free. Leonard Reed said the way to cook a frog is to put on a pot of cold water, put the frog in the water, and heat it up bit by bit. And by the time the frog realized he was being cooked, it was too late. That's the same thing with Americans. If anybody came over here talking about taking away all of our freedoms all at once, we would righteously rebel. But they can talk about taking away our freedoms bit by bit as they are doing. Now, the primary justification for the attack on private property, economic freedom, and privacy is found in people's desire for government to do good. We all say things like, government should care for the poor, government should help the disadvantaged, government should help the elderly, government should help ailing businesses, government should help college students, and other deserving segments of our society. Well, it's nice to say those things, but we have to realize that government has no resources of its very own. That is, those programs coming out of Washington or coming out of your state capital, they don't represent congressmen and senators reaching in their own pockets and sending out their money. Moreover, there's no tooth fairy or Santa Claus that gives them money. Once you recognize that government has no resources of its very own, that forces us to recognize that the only way the government can give one American citizen $1 is to first, through intimidation, threats, and coercion, confiscate that dollar from some other American. What American people do, we urge government to do things that if a private person did the identical thing, we would roundly condemn him as an ordinary, despicable, low-down thief. Let me give you an example of that. I could see an elderly lady sleeping on a grate in the dead of winter in downtown Washington. The lady needs some medical attention, some food, and shelter. I could walk up to one of you with a gun in my hand and say, give me your $200. Then having gotten your $200, I go down and buy the lady some medical attention and some food and shelter. Would you find me guilty of a crime? I surely would be guilty of crime. I'd be guilty of theft. That is taking the rightful property of one person and giving it to another to whom it does not belong. And most Americans can agree with me on that. But I ask, is there a conceptual distinction between that act, where I walked up to one of you and took your $200, and when the agents of the United States Congress, namely the IRS, they say to me, Williams, you know that $200 you earned last week that you plan to buy a nice bottle of Lafitte Rothschild Bordeaux wine with it? You will not do that. You'll give it to us, and we will go downtown and help the lady out. Is there any distinction between those two acts? There's none whatsoever. And if you press me for a distinction, the first act, where I walked up to one of you and took your $200, that is illegal theft. The second act is theft. Because keep in mind that keep in mind that theft is described as taking the rightful property of one person and giving it to another to whom it does not belong. But most Americans accept this. That is, most Americans believe that it's okay to forcibly use one American to serve the purposes of another. And keep in mind, again, a working definition of slavery is the forcible use of one person to serve the purpose of another. Now, before I leave this aspect of my talk, I personally believe in helping our fellow man in need. I think helping one's fellow man in need by reaching into one's own pockets to do so is praiseworthy and laudable. Helping one's fellow man in need by reaching into somebody else's pocket to do so is worthy of condemnation. And for the Christians among us, I'm very sure when God gave Moses the eighth commandment, thou shalt not steal, he did not mean thou shalt not steal unless you got a majority vote in the United States Congress. The free market is roundly denounced by today's defenders of the new human rights. These defenders are the chief supporters of reduced private property rights, reduced rights to profits, their anti-competition and pro-monopoly. These people in our country and elsewhere believe that they have more intelligence and superior wisdom to the masses. And they believe that they have been ordained to forcibly impose that wisdom on the rest of us, whether we like it or not. Now, of course, they have good reasons for what they're doing. But I'm here to tell you that every tyrant has had a good reason for restricting the freedom of others. The reason why the agenda of tyrants is to eliminate the free market. Why do tyrants want to eliminate the free market? Well, the free market implies voluntary transactions. And tyrants do not trust that people behaving voluntarily will do what the tyrant thinks that they ought to do. Their plan requires either the elimination or the attenuation of the market, or the elimination of peaceable voluntary exchange, or at least the attenuation of thereof. Their plan calls for economic planning. I will give you a definition of economic planning that will last you your entire lives. Economic planning is nothing more than the forcible superseding of somebody else's plan by the powerful elite. That is, for example, I might want to buy a Honda motorcycle from a Japanese producer. Well, the powerful elite will say, Williams, we're going to supersede your plan through tariffs and quotas because we think you ought to buy a Harley Davidson. Or my daughter might want to work for the hardware store guy down the street for $4 an hour. She says it's okay. The hardware store guy says it's okay. Her mother says it's okay. And her father says it's okay. But the powerful elite will eliminate that transaction because it's not being transacted at the prices they think it ought to be, namely, the minimum wage, that's just $7.25 an hour. Now, many people do all of this, they want to control our lives in the name of good. But do-gooders fail to realize that most good done in the world is not done in the name of good. Matter of fact, if you ask me, Williams, what's that noble motivation that gets the most wonderful things done? I would say greed. That is people trying to get as much as they can for themselves. I'm not talking about ripping off people, robbing people. I'm talking about people trying to get as much as they can for themselves. Now, you might not have thought it this way, but let me ask you a couple of questions. Now, last winter, you had Texas ranchers getting up in the middle of night in blizzards, running down stray cows to take care of them, feed them, inoculate them, making this huge personal sacrifice so that New Yorkers will have beef on their shelves. You have Idaho potato farmers this summer doing backbreaking work, the sun beating down them, the bugs biting them, dirt underneath their fingernails, making this personal sacrifice so that New Yorkers will also have potatoes. Now, why do you think they're doing that? Do you think they're doing that because they love New Yorkers? They may hate New Yorkers. I'm not that wild about New Yorkers myself. But they make sure that beef and potatoes gets to New York every single day of the week. Why? Because they want more for themselves. This is what Adam Smith said in the Wealth of Nations, that the social good is promoted mostly by the private interest. Now I ask you, how much beef and potatoes do you think New Yorkers would have if it all depended on human love and kindness? I'd be worried about New Yorkers. So most good done in the world is done to promote private interests. Well, let me give you another example of the virtue of self-interest and private property. You know, some people say, well, instead of using greed, why don't you say enlightened self-interest? Well, that's okay, but I like greed. It's a little more descriptive. I've often said that I don't care much about future generations. And sometimes people say, well, Williams, how come you don't care about future generations? And I ask them, what have future generations ever done for me? I mean, some kid that's going to be born in 2050, what has he done for me? How then, if he hasn't done anything for me, how then am I obliged to do anything for him? But however, if you watch my actual behavior, my behavior would make a lie of that sentiment. That is, I have a nice property in Valley Forge, Pennsylvania. And several years ago, I took $400 that I could have consumed selfishly, bought two nice bottles of Chateau de Chem Sauternes wine. But instead of doing that, I planted trees around my property. Now, when those trees reach their full maturity, I'll be dead. There'll be some 2050 kid in my trees eating my apples and pears. A number of years ago, Mrs. Williams made some extensive improvements on our house. New sunroom, with my money, by the way. And there's going to be some, the sunroom's going to outlive us. And there's going to be some 2050 kid enjoying my sunroom, tracking mud in there. Well, what might explain the sacrifice of current consumption for some good that's going to benefit a future generation? The answer is very easily. The nicer my house is, the longer it will provide housing services, what? The higher the price I get when I go to sell it. That is, by pursuing my own selfish private interests, I can't help but make a house available for a future generation, whether I mean to or not. And ask yourself, would I have the same incentives if there were a 75% transfer tax when I went to sell the house? I would not. Whatever weakens my private property rights in that house weakens my incentive to do the socially responsible thing, namely conserve on the scarce resources of our society. Well, I'm going to skip forward a few pages of my talk. You're just going to have to spend the rest of your life not knowing about these things. But one of the big problems in our country is every group has come to expect that the government owes them a special favor, or the government owes them a right to live at the expense of other people. Manufacturers feel that government should give them protective tariffs so they can charge you and me higher prices. Farmers think that government should give them crop subsidies. Labor unions think that the government should keep their jobs protected from those who are not union members. Intellectuals, college professors, think the government should give them funds to do research. And, you know, college professors love to get $100,000, $200,000, $500,000 grants to do studies on poverty and meet in the winter in a nice hotel in Florida to talk about poor people. Both conservatives and liberals prove H.L. Mencken's definition of an election quite right. As I said, conservatives rail against food stamps, aid to families of dependent children, and they come out in support for aid to dependent farmers, aid to dependent banks. Conservatives as well as liberals, Democrats as well as Republicans, prove H.L. Mencken's definition of an election quite correct. H.L. Mencken, for those of you who have forgotten, was a political satirist for the Baltimore Sun. And somebody asked H.L. Mencken to give a definition of an election. And H.L. Mencken replied, government is a broker in pillage. And every election is an advance auction on stolen goods. To the extent that H.L. Mencken is correct, we've identified our problem. Too many of us blame politicians. But politicians are doing precisely what we elect them to office do, namely use the power of their office to take what belongs to one American and give it to another American to whom it does not belong. Now you might say, well, Williams, you just insulted us. I live in North Carolina and we don't do that. Well, imagine I were running for the Senate, United States Senate in North Carolina or any state. And I go back and forth across the state and I tell the citizens of that state, look, I've read the United States Constitution. I'm going to uphold my oath of office to uphold and defend the United States Constitution. So if you elect me to Washington, don't expect for me to bring back highway construction funds, farm subsidies, aid to higher education. Do you think I would get elected to the Senate from your state? No, I wouldn't. And the people of your state would be doing absolutely the right thing by not electing me to office. Because if I don't bring back billions and billions of dollars, it doesn't mean that North Carolinians, for example, will pay lower federal income taxes. All that it means is that Virginia will get it instead. That is, once legalized theft begins, it pays for everybody to participate. Let me just close by saying that I think the founders of our nation would be very disappointed with you and me if they ever were to come back. We have abandoned many of their principles that they actually fought and died for. But the only hope for us is that throughout our history, Americans have managed not to do the wrong thing for a long time. We managed to get our act together. But we better start getting our act together while we still have the freedom to do so. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Williams. My name is Philip Anderson from Marquette University. I actually interviewed you in December for a class project, so thank you for that. Mm-hmm. And my question is, you talk a lot about race and economics and how they intersect. What is the one piece of legislation that we could pass or take away that would improve inner cities?
Well, many of the problems of black Americans and other poor people living in the city, they're caused by government. That is, as I frequently said, the welfare state has done to black Americans what slavery could not have done, Jim Crow and the harshest racism could not have done, and namely destroy the black family. And the welfare state has encouraged that. And evidence, you know, of the welfare state's power is that the welfare state has also damaged white families. That is, illegitimacy among blacks is 75%. But among whites, it's a little bit over 30%. And comparing that to 1938, the illegitimacy rate among blacks was 11% and among whites 3%. So the welfare state is no great friend of blacks. And I've also suggested, maybe people, too strong a language, but I've suggested if I were the Grand Wizard of the Ku Klux Klan and I wanted to sabotage any chance for black academic excellence, I couldn't think of a better means to do so than public school system in most cities. So I think that there are other ideas that I have that's in the book, Race and Economics, and some other publications.
Thank you. Dr. Williams, again, thank you so much for being here. You're my idol. I know you probably get that a lot. My question is, with your book, Race and Economics, which I was reading on the Amtrak here and in the few breaks we get, I bring up these statistics and arguments, and people turn up their noses or plug their ears. What can we do to make people more receptive to these statistics? Because once they hear them, it clicks for them that they're not on the right side, or that their position, I'll end it there.
Well, my answer to you is somewhat flippant, is that I've tried, and now it's your turn to try to convince them. I've spent a lot of time working on various, my very, very good friend and colleague, Thomas Sowell, has done it as well. And to some extent, we've been successful. In other ways, we've been unsuccessful. But, you younger people have much more energy than we. We've wasted our energy, or spent a lot, unwisely used a lot of our energy. So it's your turn.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Dr. Williams.
Yeah.
Thanks for coming, Dr. Williams. I'm John from Stanford University. And you mentioned earlier in your talk Article 5, and I was sort of wondering what you thought about the second provision of Article 5, the Convention of States process, which is something that Mark Levin, Mark Meckler, and some other constitutional conservatives have been promoting a lot lately.
Well, I think I disagree with Mark Levin regarding the convention, because if we had a constitutional convention again, we would not be sending people there such as George Mason, Madison, Hamilton, and Jay. We'd be sending possibly Nancy Pelosi and people of that ilk. So we could wind up losing many of the freedoms that we have now. And even among you young people, there's a survey done by the Brookings Institution that says that young people think that, the First Amendment does not protect hate speech. Over 50% of college students said that. And indeed, the First Amendment guarantees or protects just about any speech. And matter of fact, one of the things to kind of keep in mind is that the true test of one's commitment to free speech does not come when he allows people to be free to say those things with which he agrees. It comes when he allows people to be free to say those things that he finds despicable. And same thing with freedom of association. The true test of one's commitment to freedom of association does not come when you allow people to associate in ways that you deem as being okay. It comes when you allow people to associate in ways that you find despicable. So to be for liberty, you have to be a brave person. You have to be able to handle the idea or the notion that many people will behave in ways that you don't find, behave in voluntary ways that you find unacceptable.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Dr. Williams, nice to meet you. My name's Nandan. I go to law school at the University of Baltimore. My question is, constitutionally, what's the argument that could be made for funding Planned Parenthood at $500 million a year, but not funding, say, the NRA, which defends our Second Amendment rights? So why is something that's not constitutionally protected funded at $500 million a year and not something that's that defends our constitutional rights?
Well, by the way, for those of you who have not studied why the framers gave us the Second Amendment, they gave us the Second Amendment, that is, right to keep and bear arms, explicitly to enable Americans to protect themselves against what?
Government.
The government. And what government? Our government. Now, but however, I believe that Planned Parenthood would get funding because people believe in majority rule, or they believe in extra constitutional measures. That is one of the reasons why Kavanaugh is facing so much resistance to his being appointed to the Supreme Court is because he's a constitutionalist. He believes in the United States Constitution, and anyone who believes in upholding and defending the United States Constitution, he's going to make a lot of enemies with those who want government to give them special privileges.
Yeah. Thank you.
Hello, Dr. Williams. It's great to have you here. It's always an enlightening lecture with you. My name's Chase from Rider University, and I have a question. they all know me, so. So my question to you is one that I haven't easily found an answer to, and that is precisely when did the U.S. abandon the gold standard? I've attempted to research this, and I haven't found a concrete answer or point in time. And the second part of that question is there any way for the U.S. to go back on the gold standard, or is the genie out of the bottle, so to speak?
I think the genie's out of the bottle, and we went off President Nixon closed the gold window. And one of the reasons why we'll probably never go back to gold standard is that the gold standard imposed a limitation on what the federal government, what the Federal Reserve could do, and what banks could do, and in terms of creating money, and the Federal Reserve, as well as many people in Congress and Americans in general, want the Federal Reserve to be able to print money. And matter of fact, I've counseled people. I said, if you're ever on trial or standing before a judge charged with counterfeiting, just tell the judge you were engaging in monetary policy. Because that's what inflation is. It's the same as counterfeiting, where government, where the Federal Reserve prints money to pay its debts, to enable Congress to pay its debts. And by the way, they frown on us using the same mechanism or same tactic to pay our debts, namely printing money.
Thank you, sir.
Hi, Dr. Williams. My name is Adam Duarte from Loyola Marymount in Los Angeles, California. You spoke a lot about private property, and right now we have laws on the books we have anti-discrimination laws. So I just wanted to know what your opinion is and how, whether or not we need anti-discrimination laws and what the incentives are in markets for discrimination, whether or not people have that incentive.
Well, I think that anti-discrimination laws violate private property. As I said, the true test of one's commitment to freedom of association comes when he allows people to be free to associate in ways that he finds despicable. And discrimination, I wrote an article, it's carried in the Cornell Law Journal, and it's called Discrimination Versus the Law. And I argue that I give discrimination an operational definition, and discrimination is solely the act of choice. That is, when you chose to come to this conference, you discriminated against other possible uses of your time. Or, matter of fact, to put it another way, when I married Mrs. Williams, I discriminated against other women. I didn't give an equal opportunity to Japanese women, Chinese women, women with criminal records, women didn't bathe regularly. I systematically discriminated. And Mrs. Williams, she fostered that because every once in a while I thought about equal opportunity. And she would require that I continue discriminating. However, at the same time, the kind of discrimination that we saw in the United States probably would not have happened under a free market system, because people use laws to enforce discrimination. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, the streetcar services in cities like New Orleans, they did not want to discriminate against their black pastors by forcing them to sit in the back, but the city council made them do so. And if you look at there are various laws on the book during that era, and you have to ask, whenever you see a law on the book, such as that mandating racial discrimination, well, your first thought must be that law is on the book because not everybody would behave according to the specifications of that law. Not everybody would discriminate. So anyway, read the articles in the Cornell Journal of Law, and then it's referenced on my webpage, which is walterewilliams.com.
All right. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.
All right, students, before we take our next break, I just need to see the following people up front to, well, actually, Vroktep needs to see them to, sorry, we'll mispronounce your name. Jonathan Barrig, Daniel Barron, Grace Beecroft, Diego Benentes, Joshua Archbold, Raj, not even going to try, Luke Barbrick, Giada Barney, Naveed Ali, and Oliver Ahoy. If you can please meet Vroktep out front. Thank you, guys. We'll take about a 5-minute break.